Hello, I'm Ronnie Eldridge, and welcome to Keeping Relevant. My guest, Ester Fuchs, is a professor at Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs and director of the Urban and Social Policy Program. She knows everything about urban politics and policy, particularly American politics, American parties, and elections. And that's what I want to talk about today. So I'm very happy to have you here.
Boy, I couldn't be happier than to be here with you today.
Thank you. So we have this mutual admiration.
I think so.
Let's start local.
Yep.
So we had ranked choice voting. It was a success, wasn't it?
Yes, I really think ranked choice voting is a success because, you know, we're a Democratic city. And so the competition is going to be in the primaries, and by the time you get to the general election, there are very few parts of the city that can run a competitive Republican with a Democratic candidate. So we need to sort of increase the interest, the energy, and the possibilities of who can win during the primaries. And ranked choice voting does something really important. It prevents, in a multi-party race, a person from being able to win with 20% of the vote. They've got to keep accumulating at least second and third choices.
And so what percentage, do they have to have a certain percentage?
Well, yes, they have to get 51% by the end, which could be second choices or third choices.
All together,
but it changes the way people have to campaign.
Right.
They can't just target a small group and say, I'm running against five people, so I could like win with 21%.
Right.
You can't.
Yeah. It's what the Republicans are doing. It's happening in their primaries, right?
Yeah. Well, the Republicans are another story.
That's another story. We'll
right.
come to that. But in the end, only about 23% of the eligible voters voted.
So that's in the general election. And so
right.
if I had my druthers in terms of charter revision and I testified to this, I think we should have...
You were chair of the...
I chaired a charter revision commission, but we didn't take up the election issue, mostly fiscal issues.
Yeah.
But I would support an open primary. You know, I think that we should have a primary where people are identified by party, but then the two top vote getters runoff in the general election.
That's in California.
That's what California has. And that means two Democrats could be running against each other in a general election.
Yeah.
But that would create competition in the general
election. And you think the competition would stir interest?
Yeah. I mean, that's, you know, in political science, we don't know that much. But there's a few things we know about
elections. You knew everything.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to think I know a little bit, but not because I'm a political scientist. But we do know that people do not turn out when elections are not competitive, or they perceive those elections to be a done deal. Excuse me for this.
I know you have allergies.
I have allergies, but it'll
all clear. Your life?
A long time, since I'm about 12, yeah.
Yeah. But I think they also don't understand that they have a responsibility to vote. The whole system is dependent on citizen participation.
This is absolutely true, and I've done a lot of work in this area because the whole idea that people think they have a civic responsibility to vote is sort of gone. We have not successfully been teaching students in lower schools the value of participating in a democracy. You know, if you don't use it, you lose it. We know that because we're losing it here in this country right now. But we also don't have an incentive structure put into place to get people to think that voting actually makes a difference in their life. And the other thing that we don't have are institutions that actually can really help people get to the polls, understand what's going on in the elections. You're going to laugh at me.
No,
but
I'm going to say the same thing.
The old party machine.
Absolutely.
That's what they did.
Absolutely.
They incorporated people into the democratic process.
Right. Absolutely. That was me.
Yeah, but not, you know, not everything they did.
I met
you know.
Two husbands through politics.
There you go. Well, you won big.
I did have a good record. Anyway, I had a civics teacher in seventh grade at Joan of Arc Junior High School. And my family helped because they were interested in what was going on. And it was during Roosevelt, so it was really, you know. But that civics teacher was wonderful. And that's what?
Into the high schools. So there is curriculum, and it should be in the high schools. We should be registering kids to vote in the high schools as well, a little more effectively. Right. But in the end, you know, one of the really weird and interesting statistics is that if you have just registered to vote, you are actually least likely to turn out. Registering doesn't mean you're going to turn out.
Right.
So we can register people, but that doesn't mean they're going to engage afterwards. So we need that process that really connects people to the electoral process. It's something I have a new project that I'm working on that I haven't even told you about yet. It's called Community Speak. So who's on the ballot is that little thing mm-hmm. just giving people information.
It's whosontheballot.org.
Correct.
And that'll tell you who is on the ballot
exactly,
that you're going to vote for.
Yeah. And where to vote.
Right.
Simple, very simple and basic, because that's what a lot of people want and need. This other project I'm doing called Community Speak came out around during COVID, because I was working with some people in the medical school, and they were looking at the public health impacts of COVID, especially in high needs communities. And, you know, as things progressed, we realized that it wasn't just health effects, that COVID was having broad effects, both in the economic and social conditions of people in the city, especially in a lot of the high needs communities. And I said, you know, that was when de Blasio was mayor, like, what are we doing to get to these people? Do we have any data, for example, to understand what's going on differently in different parts of the city? And can we be nimble? You mm-hmm. know, can we target resources then to where the mm-hmm. needs are? So we put together this project, which is essentially a survey, but we partner with community-based organizations. Because, you know, we learned something very important, right. which we knew, and I'm sure you knew when we were trying to get those vaccines out,
right.
that vaccine hesitancy can be impacted when a trusted messenger comes to a person
right.
and explains to them the value of the vaccine. And those are the people in neighborhood organizations, in churches, in places, local doctors even.
This is the future.
That's right.
You know, whether doing it with mental health.
And we should be doing more
right.
of it, and we're not. But what we're also not doing is collecting the data right. in a consistent way. We don't have new information. You have to be nimble.
That's why you're a scientist.
So right? I try and be a social scientist a little bit, you
yeah.
know, because I want my students, before they do their advocacy work, to actually have the data
right.
and understand, you know, what's causing problems, so that when you come up with a policy solution, you know, you're
yeah.
not sitting in your closet making it up or throwing everything against the wall to see what sticks.
Yeah.
You know, you can actually target.
Have a basic foundation.
That's
so
right.
Do you think these community organizations are going to eventually take the place of the local political clubs?
So it's so interesting. They should be,
yeah, right?
Right. But in fact, most of them are not. Most of them do not connect their communities to the elections. So the advocacy organizations do what they do in the period between elections, but there's very little, for my money, voter registration going on or continuous engagement. There's a couple of them who do it, right? League of Conservation Voters.
Mm-hmm.
They have it in their name.
Right.
They know what they're doing. They're registering, they're advocating,
they came
they're
out
informing.
Of politics.
And they're, yes, and they are, you know, they're an organization, they're a membership organization.
Yeah. Right.
And they register people to vote, and they keep in touch with them. This is part of the process, so those people have a reason to vote, because they know people stand, for example, on the environmental issues. Most people, and this is what we also know from research, most people, A, they don't think politicians understand people like them. Unfortunately, this is why Trump ascended, which is incredibly fascinating and scary in so many ways. But people don't think a regular politicians understand people like them. And they do not think, in general, that there's a reason for them to vote, that it won't make a difference. And so we, in the city, at the local level, we really have an opportunity. this is the thing that I'm most optimistic about. We actually, if we do the work, can mm-hmm. connect people back to the political mm-hmm. process. I think, you know, the problem of democratic resilience and of people viewing government as not legitimate can only be fixed if people reconnect
right.
to government. And this is where we have to do it.
So we have here. To go into the schools of social work and all these different places. Very successful politicians have come from being organizers.
Absolutely, right. Right. When AOC won and beat Joe Crowley in that primary, of which nobody except I think my doorman Felix knew that she was going to win, and he's, you know, part of 32BJ,
yeah.
and he lived in that neighborhood, and he told me she was going to win, and I, like, looked at him. But there was a 13% turnout.
Yeah.
But she had an organization.
Where she knew where to go.
That's right. She had an organization. She had young people. She had the Democratic Socialists. And Crowley was asleep at the wheel, thinking he was entitled to represent that district forever,
yeah.
living in Washington, D.C., where nobody, you know, Felix said to me, Crowley's going to lose. I said, how do you know that? He said he didn't show up at the gay pride parade in Queens. We have to get engagement done in a broader way so people have a reason to be part of the political process and to vote in these local elections.
Right.
And not just understand that their vote makes a difference, but that, in fact, city government makes a difference in their life. We
right.
have to explain that to them.
You're right. As you watch election returns nationally and everything, you know, you see the Republican candidate is ahead, but because the city hasn't had its vote in yet, it's not a true result, right?
Right.
So is that what we're gonna have, is this division between the American public gonna be rural versus urban?
Yeah, we have, we're so polarized at this point in
yeah.
American history. You have to go very far back, close to the Civil War, to find this level of polarization by party, by rural, urban, and region. So the polarization is so deep and so serious, and it's reinforced now by the gerrymandering.
Right.
And so we've got what you said, the rural, urban.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, the Republican Party has essentially taken over all of rural America.
Mm-hmm.
Now, theoretically, the people live in the cities. The Democrats should be winning with the urban vote, but we know why they don't. Between the Electoral College, the Senate, these are not one person, one vote institutions,
right.
and the gerrymander, which, you know, again, Democrats were asleep at the wheel when Republicans were taking over state legislatures, which draw the lines, and then staking over state courthouses. So this.
Were you surprised about the state legislatures?
You know, I have this really interesting colleague, Alex Hertel Fernandez, and he wrote a book called State Capture. So I was like, got a little insight into this before it became, you know, it blew up as an issue, but I was surprised when I read this book. He did a book about that organization called ALEC, which is the conservative think tank that provides templates for legislation to state legislators. Now, most of these are, you know, they're not paid well, they have no time, they have no staff.
Right.
And he did this amazing study. He used the plagiarism software programs, and he put the template in that was produced by ALEC, and then he put legislation in from all these different states, and lo and behold, they were exactly what ALEC was producing and giving to them, and they were just taking it and using it. Yeah. So this was a clue, like, you know, who was doing that on the other side? And so we've been losing the state legislatures for quite some time without even knowing it. It's like the Federalist Society grooming the judges and making them all ready so that when Trump won, he just pulled that list and just started appointing those judges.
You've done a lot of stuff on foreign cities.
Yes, I've done
some stuff. So do they have the same characteristics that we have?
You know, they have a lot of the same policy issues, but the difference in a lot of these cities is the political structure. And where, you know, we have a more robust democratic political structure in our cities because we've got an executive and a legislative branch, and we, you know, our judicial system is structured that way. And, you know, we both go back to the 75 fiscal crisis, you and I.
Yeah.
And, you know, this was part of the problem for cities like New York. And now, you know, you see Adams having to deal with this again.
Yeah.
The asylum seekers should not be New York City's problem. We should not, we could deal with it, but we should not be paying for it. That doesn't happen in Europe. It's right. paid for by Biden, the national government.
Well, does this mean that Biden doesn't have a commitment, a strong commitment to?
This is a particular disappointment to me that he hasn't picked this up,
yeah.
because I just think they don't have a policy for immigrants, and they have too many things. You know, they're fighting that public relations war with the Republicans, who always seem on immigration and crime to be right. ahead of the Democrats in fashioning a message that's.
But they're not helping
bogus.
With housing.
No, but when's the last time they really helped with housing?
A long time ago.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we had Sean Donovan in there when Barack Obama was president. So then he ran for mayor, and I have to say, he's, you know, I know him from the Bloomberg administration. He's a very smart guy. But I was like, excuse me, you were the secretary of HUD, and you're talking about in this race how you're going to fix New York City Housing Authority when you didn't put an extra nickel into the Housing Authority? Where, you know, yeah. now we actually have the possibility of fixing things now because of this, what was passed in the state legislature with these trusts. Mm-hmm. So there is money going to come in for repair.
I remember looking for more money in the Lindsay administration.
There
that
you
was
go.
1969. Yeah. What kind of students, your own program?
I'm so fortunate. I run this urban policy program. I have 140 students. They're from all over the world. And they're amazing. You know, when I started teaching, people thought urban was social policy. It's all about poor people, what you do for poor people. The most exciting environmental sustainability plans are coming from cities from all over the globe, from the C40, which was created by Michael Bloomberg. This is where the action is for the kids who want to save the planet. They know working in cities is a place where you can start and get things done. It's not, you know, you still need national and global policy for the environment, but there's so much we are doing.
And do they learn the skill then of how to attract other cities and national political figures?
Yeah, I mean,
does that come naturally, or does that come from an education?
It's so interesting what you're saying. Well, we have now Mayor Nutter, the former mayor of Philadelphia, who has the
He's great. I love him.
Oh, my God. He's fabulous. He has the David Dinkins chair.
Yeah.
Michael Nutter has been so great for the students because we have professors of practice. So he came in as a professor of practice. So he teaches two urban courses. One is leadership course, and one is, you know, practical problems and solutions.
Yeah.
And what, you know, part of, because we have such an international student body, all of us try and make sure that, I say this in the beginning of class, you have to bring your experiences to this classroom from your city. Like, I can't know everything about every city in the world. So, you know, if you're coming from Manila, I'm going to be asking you when we have the big questions to address that and how you're doing it there.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just had this semester, I had amazing papers. You know, I had one on New York on how to deal with the, one on how to deal with the teacher shortage. But it wasn't in New York. They were using information from how they're doing it in Sri Lanka to learn from this. But my view, when you do these kinds of comparative studies, that you have to have a set of questions to ask, because like we said, the political structure might be different, the funding structure might be different.
Yeah.
So what's very clear is a lot of the problems are the same, but there is a lot of creativity, especially around smart cities, for example, in other places that we're not doing here, where they're using technology way more effectively than we do here. And they're using data, I hate to say it, more effectively. To say we're data-driven doesn't mean you're really using the data to make policy.
Yeah.
And that, you know, there's a big disconnect there, unfortunately.
You like data.
I like to have the data to start. Yeah, I do, because it really helps orient things. Mm-hmm. The economists laugh at me because I'm not constrained by the data. Mm-hmm. You see, for them, some are very creative, but everything has to be quantified. So if it's not quantified, you can't, like, ask the question. To me, I just want to ask the interesting question. And if there's data, great. If it's qualitative and we have to do case studies to figure things out.
So you went and worked for mayor.
I did.
You were a special assistant to Mayor Bloomberg.
I did.
Were you surprised when you got into the government?
Oh my God, yes. And I, you know, it was an extraordinary experience of my life. It changed the way I think and it changed the way I teach. And I'll tell you a funny story. I mean, you know, I was very fortunate to be in the first term. A lot happened in the first term. And, you know, Mayor Bloomberg brought in a lot of different kinds of people. And for me, I worked the campaign. And then he said, come into government. And I was like, who are you talking to? Like, it never even occurred to me that I would have a skill set to do what needed to be done. I literally said to him, what will I do? Said, you know, you'll bring new ideas in. And he kind of knew what I would do before I did. But the surprising thing, which is going to make you laugh, so I'm in that bullpen and I invite one of my friends from Columbia, Catherine Utrakis, who I always adored and very savvy. And I wanted her to see the bullpen. And we're sitting in there and I looked at her and I said, Catherine, everything is so political here. And she looked at me and she started shaking me, literally, physically. She goes, you're a political scientist, for God's sake. Of course it's political. What were you expecting? You know, I was in a different kind of halo mindset,
so
right?
Yeah.
But yeah, so.
So you got used to it.
I did, and I put my head down, which was hard for me, as you can imagine. I didn't talk to the press for 4 years, almost, really.
Right.
And I picked very complex problems that needed interagency coordination that I knew other people would not be interested in doing and that were not kind of the lead story.
Yeah.
And so I worked on workforce development, which I reorganized, and I worked on after school. I mean, I did other things as well, but I did these big reorganizations, and then I did something called the Integrated Human Service Project, which was to bring technology to the application process for needs-based benefits, which we did. And it's called Access New York now, but
good.
I mean, this was when I started to do that because of 9/11.
Yeah.
Because there were so many people
right.
who affected. Had been displaced.
Now we're almost finished with this
right?
program.
Oh my God.
Tell me who your student is in the White House.
Corinne Jean-Pierre. Oh my God.
When she was a student, could you ever imagine she was going to be a press secretary?
I knew she was going to be amazing. She was, you know, this was a course in parties and elections that she was in. And I'll tell you, who was with her was another young woman named Christina Greer, who you may see on MSNBC.
She's a
tenured professor at Fordham now.
Yeah.
So Christina stayed was doing the PhD, and Corinne was doing the MPA. And they both were outstanding. And I knew that good things were going to happen. And the funny thing is you know, Corinne, I do see, and we're in touch, but Christine, I see a lot, and she said to me, you know, I met Corinne in your class, and I had no idea, which
nice.
For students, it's great for me.
Yeah.
I'm so proud.
Well, we breezed through this half hour so quickly, so you've got to come back again. I love that you've not lost any enthusiasm. Every year it gets more, in a way.
Oh, well, you know what? You bring it out. I think of all the amazing work you did, and I feel like, you know, we have to continue doing the work.
Yeah, you appreciate some of it.
I appreciate
anyway,
it all.
It's lovely. And a grandmother.
Yes. Oh, Nama, my baby Nama.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ronnie.